Welcome, I'm Bill Everett, your host, and in this episode, we'll explore the string quartets of Mozart. Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart is one of the most famous figures in the European musical heritage. He has even become a pop culture phenomenon of sorts in the 20th and 21st centuries. There's Mozart Kugeln from his native city of Salzburg, Austria, Delectable Delights, a pistachio, marzipan, and nougat covered in dark chocolate. In terms of theater, Peter Schaeffer's 1979 play Amadeus and its 1984 film adaptation did a great deal to popularize the composer and his work. And in the 21st century, two musicals feature the iconic composer as the title character, Mozart, Das Musical, which had its premiere in Vienna in 1999 and was revived in 2015, and Mozart, L'Opera Rock, or Mozart, the Rock Opera, a French musical spectacle first performed in 2009. It has often been said that everything Mozart wrote was opera. He conceived of music as dramatic storytelling, and his melodies have an inherent vocal quality. It's just that sometimes his operas were not staged works for singers and orchestra, but could take the guise of a symphony, a work for solo piano, a piano concerto, or a string quartet. There's a myth about Mozart that everything came easily to him when it concerned music. Stories abound that he could imagine pieces in his mind fully formed and only had to write them down. While Mozart certainly did possess extraordinary musical abilities, he sometimes struggled to create music that met his exacting standards. One genre in which he himself said it was difficult to write was the string quartet. Mozart had tremendous respect for his older contemporary, Joseph Haydn, especially how Haydn could handle the string quartet genre with such innovation and supposed ease. Mozart lived at a time when the idea of the string quartet as a genre was becoming codified. Prior to the 1770s, it was typical to describe multi-movement works according to their function as various types of background music. Divertimentos, diversions. Serenades, works to be played around sunset. Nocturnes, music to be savored after nightfall. The instrumentation was not key to the work's titles, for all these sorts of collections could be scored for various combinations of instruments, strings, and winds. In early 1772, Mozart wrote a series of three captivating works he called Divertimento, diversions. These three movement delights were not intended necessarily for focused listening, but rather were created as amusements to provide an aural atmosphere for various sorts of gatherings. Here's the opening of Mozart's Divertimento in F, Kürschel 138. Before progressing further, it's worth talking about the Kürschel, or K numbers, that one often sees as part of the titles of works for those by Mozart. The K stands for Kürschel, referring to Ludwig von Kürschel, who compiled a complete list of works by Mozart in the 19th century. Kürschel arranged the works in what, to his best knowledge, was chronological order. So K1, a minuet, was the earliest surviving piece written by Mozart, composed when he was just 5 years old. As we'll see, the minuet will play a significant role in Mozart's string quartet writing. The last K number, K626, goes with the Requiem, which Mozart left incomplete at the time of his death. But back to our story. As the 1770s progressed, composers began to label works for certain combinations of instruments according to the ensemble. For example, as trios for piano, violin, and cello, as string trios, or as string quartets. Part of this certainly had to do with Joseph Haydn and his codification, not invention, of the string quartet as a genre. Haydn's model, which other composers followed, consisted of a four-movement structure. An opening movement in a moderate to fast tempo, sometimes with a slow introduction, followed by a slow movement, then a dance movement, and concluding with a lively finale. Sometimes the middle two movements would be reversed, with a dance movement coming before the slow one. In 1782, Mozart published a set of six string quartets as his Opus 10. Opus numbers refer to the order of publication for a composer's works, which usually follows when they were written, but not always. Mozart dedicated this set to Haydn, writing, and I quote, "To my dear friend Haydn, a father who has decided to send his children out into the great world, felt that it was his responsibility to confide them to the protection and guidance of a very celebrated man, especially when the latter, by good fortune, was at the same time his best friend. Here they are then, O great man and dearest friend, these six children of mine. They are, it is true, the fruit of a long and laborious effort," end quote. This praise was certainly not one-sided, for Haydn wrote enthusiastically to Wolfgang's father, Leopold, and I quote, "I say to you before God, and as an honest man, that your son is the greatest composer known to me personally or by reputation. He has taste, and what is more, the greatest knowledge of composition," end quote. As far as the internal order movements is concerned, three of these quartets had the slow movement coming before the dance movement, while in the other three, the dance movement comes first. The quartets are each truly unique creations, filled with different musical atmospheres and unorthodox harmonies, the underpinnings of melodies, many of which were extremely unusual for the time. Mozart was challenging the norms as to how notes could be heard both vertically, that is, harmonically, and horizontally, or melodically. We'll have a quick sampling of a small handful of some of the extraordinary moments in these six quartets. In the first quartet of the set, the final movement presents the themes in a fugal manner, with each instrument playing the same melody in succession to create an ever-increasingly complex texture. Haydn was known for his fugal writing in his earlier string quartets, and Mozart pays homage to Haydn's gift in this regard. Notice again this independence of parts. The second quartet of the set is in the key of D minor, a key which Mozart used for especially intense works. The pitch D is one of the open strings of all four of the instruments in the string quartet, and as such, it has a particular resonance due to the construction of the instruments and the laws of acoustics. Mozart also used this particular key for his piano concerto number 20 with its tumultuous opening. The statue scene in his opera, Don Giovanni, where a statue of the man the title character killed early in the opera accepts the Don's dinner invitation. And the Requiem, Mozart's chilling mass for the dead. This sense of drama and foreboding is certainly present in the opening of this string quartet. The slow movement of the third quartet is famous for its innovative chromatic harmony, that is, introducing notes that are not in the fundamental key of the work. It's like interjecting the notes played by the black keys of the piano in music that only uses the white keys. the cellist gets to play a most extraordinary bass line at the beginning of the movement. The dance movements of these quartets, as well as most other string quartets, are often overlooked, or at least given short coverage in many discussions of the genre. They are too frequently viewed as throwaways in the midst of more serious movements. But these minuets are much more than trivialities. They offer aural images of the public and private worlds associated with the realm of the dance. Dancing was a vital part of social life in the latter 18th century. The minuet was a stately dance performed at court and in formal settings. It is a couple's dance with precise moves for the feet and the hands. At formal gatherings, couples would take to the dance floor to dance the minuet in order of increasing social rank. So, in the early United States, for example, if President George and Mrs. Martha Washington were in attendance, they would be the last to dance. It was very much a dance to be watched as well as to be danced. And this is what Mozart gives us in his stylized minuets. The more extroverted outer sections, which consist of the same music, reflect the very public world of the courtly minuet. They surround what is called a trio section that tends to be more intimate and of a slightly different nature. This represents two people dancing. Intimacy. It is as if we have a large panoramic shot of a ballroom floor, the outer sections, and then focus on a single couple, the trio, before returning to the panoramic view. Let's experience one of these splendid evocations of a stately dance. Here's the Dover Quartet performing the second movement of the fifth quartet in the set, an exquisite minuet and trio. Thank you. Mozart continued to write string quartets after this magnificent group of six, though he did so only four times. The so-called Hofmeister Quartet was published on its own in 1786 by Franz Anton Hofmeister, hence its nickname. Mozart's final set of three quartets were written for Friedrich Wilhelm II, King of Prussia, who was a very fine amateur cellist. Many composers at the time wrote chamber music for the king to perform, including Joseph Haydn and Luigi Boccherini, the latter a very fine and renowned cellist. Mozart's set of quartets, as one would expect considering the reason they were written, feature the cello extensively. Here's a bit of the opening of the second of the three quartets. Did you notice how this quartet sounds somehow different from the minuet we heard moments ago? This has to do with how Mozart is thinking about the very sound of the string quartet. In the earlier example, the violin dominated, as was the norm at the time. So the other three instruments accompany in an appropriate range, playing sounds not that far from those of the violin. But when the cello is the focal instrument, everything needs to be pulled down in pitch. Otherwise, it would sound very odd, with a huge gulf between the cello on the bottom and the other instruments playing in their traditional ranges. So, to accommodate the cello, Mozart brings the other three instruments lower in their ranges to be closer to that of the cello. The result is a richer and more velvety sound. Now that we've realized how Mozart creates this different sound, let's listen to the beginning of the second movement of the same quartet, which again features the cello. As we discussed earlier, it could be said that everything Mozart wrote was opera. It's just that sometimes there weren't singers. To conclude this episode, we'll hear a stunning aria, coupled with a glorious duet and a famed ensemble piece. But we aren't going to be listening to an opera. Instead, we'll hear how Mozart uses all these operatic building blocks in the guise of a string quartet. We'll return to the first of that famous set of quartets Mozart dedicated to Haydn to hear its evocative third movement. Here's the Ariel Quartet.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us in this exploration of the string quartets of Mozart. I'm Bill Everett, and I hope we'll see you again for other episodes.